Sometimes she laughs when it's not funny, though.
You seem like an affable fellow.
That's a new word, affable. Oh, it's the same word as in
is
French.
It the same in
affable,
French?
Yeah.
So you've made a very happy movie.
It's a comedy.
It's a comedy. Yeah. You're going to make it into a musical on Broadway soon.
Actually, in Sundance, a Indian producer came to me and he gave me his card and he said, I want to do a remake of your film. And I said, you're going to make a musical out of my film? And he looked at me very seriously. He said, no, this is not a Bollywood film. So I thought I was, you know, going to have my Bollywood remake, but it's not going to happen.
It'd be an interesting Bollywood movie remake.
Yeah, but why not?
I wonder if they do Bollywood with kids. That would be...
Oh.
I mean, because that relationship could be very Bollywood-y.
That's right. The discovering of the hanging, dancing and singing.
It would be. It is a conceptual idea that fits.
Yeah, I'm going to think about it.
Well, they've done Canadian Bollywood-style movies, a couple of them at least.
Well, we have a Canadian filmmaker, Deepa Mehta. Who hasn't done really Bollywood?
She hasn't really done Bollywood, yeah.
No, but she's well known, and she was she was nominated for an Oscar, I think, for Water.
Yeah,
a few years back, and now I know that there's this film called in English it's Seducing Dr. Henry. Mm-hmm. No, I'm sorry, it's not that. It's a Starbuck, which is a high concept movie of a guy who donated his sperm for many years when he was young, and he learns that he has 500 kids now, and he has a lawsuit against him, so. The Indians have asked for the rights for a remake, and they've offered money, and they said, either you take the deal now, or we were going to make the film anyway, and we're not going to pay anything after.
Right.
So that's the first country where they sold the remake rights, because the Indians said, it's a take it or leave it offer, we're going to make the film.
And it's called Starbucks because it happens in a Starbucks?
No, it's called Starbucks because it was his name as a donor. He called himself Starbuck, and he was a very potent donor.
Apparently.
Anyway.
Big Battlestar Galactica fan. You are, too.
I am. I used to watch the old series in the 1970s, and I'm a huge fan of the new series.
So are you a geek?
At home, if you go through my apartment, you wouldn't say I'm a geek. But I like sci-fi a lot. Uh-huh. I come from a family where everybody used to watch Star Trek. Mm-hmm. And every time there's a new Star Trek in the cinema, we go together as a family, the four boys and the mother and the father.
Wow.
I would love to die. I'm not into, I don't think I'll do any studio movies, but a Star Trek, perhaps. I would say yes to a Star Trek.
So you like the reboot?
Yes.
The J.J. reboot?
Absolutely. I think he saved the franchise. I think he saved the franchise because the films before that were really crappy.
And were you watching Deep Space Nine, or were you just...
Yeah, I watched all of them except the new series Star Trek, but the prequel to Star Trek. I didn't watch that.
Not so great.
Yeah.
Oh, well. So were you a film nerd? Let's put you in a box, because we like to do that in Hollywood. We
get
you in a box immediately.
You have to understand that I never studied film. I never thought I would be making films. I knew that I would be making films at the age of 32, 33. And I used to go watch films that my mother and father would, you know, bring us to. And they were French comedies, old French comedies, Louis de Funès, Pierre Richard. And when I was old enough to go see films by my home with my friends, we went to see Poltergeist. I was very big on Steven Spielberg. Ironically, Steven Spielberg, who encompasses everything that Hollywood is the first guy who made me realize that there was a director behind a film.
Hmm.
You know, when you're young, you go see a film because there's this actor or because it's an action flick.
Right.
But I wanted to see more films by Steven Spielberg. And then I saw Amadeus, which changed my perception on films because all of a sudden I understood that films were something more than just something entertaining. But I was a very, very late bloomer as a film goer. And I saw, you know, World Cinema came to me, or I went to to see World Cinema film in the middle of the 90s only.
So what did you want to be when you were 25?
I wanted to dig wells in Africa, or I wanted to work in foreign affairs, or I studied in political science and international relations.
Mm-hmm.
And it was only a series of accidents that led me to cinema.
So were you serious about that? I mean, did you want to save the world, or did you like the whole process of
traveling? I wanted to travel more than save the world. I knew that I knew then, and I know now that the world cannot be saved. You can only try to do a little, you know, your part, but it won't be saved. It's fucked. And but I wanted to travel.
Put that on a bumper sticker.
Yeah. And the world is fucked. Do
Don't
your
save
best
the
anyway.
World.
Yeah. But I wanted to travel. And the biggest opportunity I had was I was watching this program on Canadian television, French television, called The Race Around the World, La Course Autour du Monde. Every year they chose 8 young contestants without amateur, and they would give them cameras, and they would have to travel alone around the world for 6 months, and they had to do 20 short films in 26 weeks.
Huh.
So I applied for that in 1992, and to my surprise, they eventually chose me. I had no prior experience with a camera.
Huh.
So I went around the world and I had to do 20 short films. So you would get in a country, find a subject, shoot with SVHS camera, no time code, no side screens.
Uh-huh.
I would lock myself in a hotel room for 2 days. I would edit the film on paper by looking at the, you know, the images through the viewfinder and having my chronometer timing the images. I would send my editing plan and my stuff to Montreal by FedEx and move on to the next country. And that was going on for 26 weeks.
Wow.
And the films were shown like 4 weeks later before a panel of judges on television, and they would mark our film.
Uh-huh.
They would mark our film, and there was
you were
a standing.
Still on the road while there was...
I was still on the road, and there was a standing. It was like the ancestor of reality show, but an intelligent reality show.
Was fascinating. So, and all of you were basically, this is the way you did it, was to edit conceptually, and
yeah.
Then
it was all in my head
because
I saw my 20 films when I came back to Montreal. Like, I left in August, and then I came back the next year in February, and then I sat down and I watched all my 20 films for the first time.
Did they look like you thought they would look?
They looked exactly like I thought they would look, and when they were looking really bad, it was exactly what I asked, and that was the learning process, actually.
Uh-huh.
And nowadays, when I write a script or I try to figure out how I'm going to shoot a scene, I do exactly what I did back then. I just close my eyes and I try to visualize the end product.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was my cinema school. I never went never studied cinema.
Was there a voice that came out of this experience, or have you been still developing that as to what your kind of directorial idea of the world is?
No, I think for instance, if you look at Monsieur Lazhar, my last film, there's an immigrant, and people have been asking me, you know, have you been interested in immigration for a long time? I think it goes back to that time where I was the immigrant.
Hmm.
I was the one not fitting in the society. I knew nothing about, nor the language, nor their habits, and I was trying to understand a piece of their world and try to convey it on a small film and move on to the other countries. And when I came back home in 1993, I was always interested in the immigrant experience. And I knew at one point I wanted to do a film around an immigrant character. And what I liked about the material around Monsieur Lazhar is that, of course, he's an immigrant. He's a refugee, and it's important to his background story, but it's not the main focus of the film.
So the films were, these short films were all narrative style?
They could be anything I wanted. They could be an abstract film about an object.
Right.
You know, we tried to meet the other. We tried, I tried to let the people I met talk to us through my films. But if I was depressed in a room in Burundi, Africa on Christmas Eve, I could do a small piece on my own depression lost in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
So we had carte blanche. We could do anything we wanted.
And you did do that? Or did you?
I did. I did do a film on my own depressive state in Africa in a room that was full of large, long cockroaches like that everywhere in my bed, in the bathtub. And that was kind of a turning point also in my race, where I began to do much more stronger films and more interesting films, because I was too minded, I was too journalistic minded at the beginning. You know, I needed to answer the usual questions of where, what, when, how, and then I realized I have a camera, I have the world, I can tell, you know, all the stories I want. So
Monsieur Lazhar is not your original concept?
No.
Well, how did you find it? How did you run into it in the first place?
I saw a play 5 years ago, and I just was struck by the complexity and the richness of the character.
It was a one-man show?
It was a one-man show. He was alone on stage, and the way it was not really a monologue, almost a monologue, but he would speak to people who were not there, so he would, were going to be holes in the dialogues, and then you would imagine what the person would answer back and by his reaction. And so I guess that as any spectator back then, I was imagining the other characters around him. So I guess I was drafting my first version of the script. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I had been looking for a point of entry into immigration as a subject. And I thought that was perfect because it's there. It's there in the story. It's there in the background, but it's not the main focus of the story.
So they say don't work with dogs and children. You decided to work with a lot of children.
Yeah, don't work with dogs and children. I think that's unfair to dogs. I like working with animals. No, I working with children is more work, but it's not more difficult. It's just that you have to understand that they cannot do their homework alone. So you need to put more time and more resources. Mm-hmm. But you have to give more in this hand, but they will give you back much more. Mm-hmm. So it's a fair process. And I'm not alone. I work with a coach. She's there all the time when I rehearse with them, so she knows where I want to take the kid. Mm-hmm. So when I'm off on other tasks, she can continue rehearsing with them. I remember some shots, some scenes where we were doing, and I was quite satisfied. And then she would, pull me apart, and she would say, 5 minutes before when we were rehearsing, he was much better than that. So don't be satisfied with that. So it's okay. So she would, help me push them further also.
Because the kids are pretty well balanced in terms of, they're really the co-leads. They're not like secondary characters who happen to be there.
Yeah.
Did you write the script and anybody go, you're crazy to be doing this? You're putting yourself
in danger? No. But, look at the history of cinema. There are a lot of good films with children that are the main character. And
many
I had done...
French. Actually, most of them in French.
Yes, that's right. That's right. When we think about Truffaut or Louis Malle, yeah, you're right. And so I had done a movie with a kid as the main character called It's Not Me, I Swear. Mm-hmm. And he was in every shot of the film. So I had prior experience with that. So now I was tackling a whole class, but still it's the same. It was the same thing for me. And it was important for me while writing the script to have different point of views in the film. So I had the Monsieur Lazhar point of view, and I wanted two other children to be important characters and to give the point of view of the children.
Well, in many cases, he's really just the observer, which I guess is very different than being a one-man show.
He's more than the observer because he instinctively knows that the children need some spark and need to talk about what happened. So I think he's really active in a way, and he's active for his own sake also, even though he doesn't realize it. Mm-hmm. He also bears the scars of losing his family. And he doesn't want to talk about it. He doesn't want to reveal his secret to anyone. But he's so obsessed by the grieving of the children that I think he needs also to talk about his own grieving. I think he's an accidental teacher. Yeah. He needs to be teaching on this particular year to this particular class. So we will help the class and the class will help him.
Well, and that in terms of the story is that's completely true. It's the circumstance that brings him to being a teacher is one in a thousand, one in a million, one in a...
Yeah, that was a problem for me. In the play, you learn midway in the play that the teacher that he replaces committed suicide. Not only she committed suicide, but she did it in the class. Now, in the play, you kind of accept that, especially at a play where there's only one man on stage and it's supposed to be happening in a school. So you know that the convention of theater forces you to imagine the rest. But in the cinema, you want to see things. So I was stuck with the problem, do I show it? And when do I show it? I wrote the first drafts without showing the hanging. It started 3 days after the hanging, but I came to realize that if you want to feel something with the children at some point, especially at the cathartic moment at the end, you have to discover the body with the children. So I wrote that scene where they discover the body, and I thought, wow, this is far-fetched to have someone hanging in her own class. But The reality goes way beyond that, because after making the film, I've learned so many stories about suicide around school. And recently in France, 3 months ago, a teacher committed suicide in the schoolyard. She set herself on fire. She was the victim of a lot of harassment, and she. So you know, it's in the fiction. It's tough to imagine that somebody would do something like that, but then in real life, much more worse thing happens.
Well, and in the movie, in the story, it is kind of like an act of nature. It's one of those things that the whole point of it, I feel like, through the film, is that it's not something that can be explained. It's not something that we can control. It's not something that's meant to be understood. It just is.
Everybody
has to react.
It's the inciting incident of the film. And what's interesting with a person that commits suicide is not her motivation. We don't know her motivation. She's dead. And she brings that secret with her. It's the living. What happens to the living? What happens to the people who are stuck there and have to continue on living in the very same room, also in the very same class? So you're right about that. But I knew that, because when in cinema you're dealing with real objects, the audience would have real question regarding the hanging. You cannot not talk about the hanging throughout the film. So just by having the main character, Monsieur Lazhar, just asking why did she do it in the class, I think is enough for us to okay, so people are actually asking these questions.
Well, it's an interesting thing about this film, because usually you have a protagonist who is carrying the water for the audience, is the object of the audience's idea. In this movie, all those characters, each of them brings a different perspective, but they're not inherently conflictual.
No.
Because they're, you know, each one of them has variations on their sense of what is important and how to proceed, and including the children. They're not they're not passive participants in this.
Probably the toughest thing when you're writing a script is to make sure that the secondary characters are not just sidekicks. Are not there just to listen to the main character. I hate those. And they're so many of those characters in cinema. Personally, I think it's lazy script writing. You have a main character, he has his own objective, he has his own goal, even though sometimes he doesn't know what his goal is, but you have a sense of that there's a subject around the film, there's an issue going on. And if you can have secondary characters rich enough that they have their own perspective on what's going on, and they have their own. My test is, every time I draw a character, if I take the character out of the film, is he interesting? Is she interesting? If yes, I can put him back in the film. If no, I try to do without that character. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about death in school, but also the main issue, one important issue is the whole thing about touching or not touching children at school. You know, showing affection to children at school. Every character has his own idea and problematic around that issue.
And the kids are, you know, the two kids are both kind of remarkable. They would both really, I actually thought the kid who was the boy child, who was kind of the boy lead of the kids, really was almost his own movie, or could be his own movie.
Yeah.
And the girl is extraordinary. I mean, she really, were they easy to find? Or they're just kid actors, or?
You often expect a story like, yeah, we did 1,000 auditions and It was fairly fast. It was over a period of a month and a half. I saw about 200 kids. I saw all of them for the two main roles. And then when I liked them but didn't think they were right for the role, I used them for other roles. And I took my time with the kids during the audition. It's really meeting the person that's in front of you, making sure also that the parents are the right parents for that process. You're auditioning not the kids but also the parents. And the young girl was, for me, is the best actress in the whole film. She's very good, and she has these eyes, the eyes of an adult in a baby face. So it's very, very weird when you look at her. There's something, just looking at her, that you feel something. And the boy, well, he was more emotional in real life and regarding the issue of suicide. So when he has his big dramatic scene, I think he dug inside of him in real, you know, sentiment and emotion to bring us that. as for the girl, she's an actress, so she would be able to do her speech in front of the class very dramatically. And as soon as I said cut, she would look at me like that and said, "You want another one?" You know, she would be able to be so professional about it and not affected by it.
Has she done much stuff before?
No, she hadn't. But now she's working a lot.
I can imagine.
Yeah, yeah. And she doesn't want to become an actress because she's a gymnast. She's a very good gymnast, where we think she has good chances of going to the Olympics one day. And when I asked her, "Do you want to keep doing films?" And she says, "There's a lot of waiting and doing nothing when you do films. I think I prefer gymnastic." And I said, "Good for you."
So do you set tone with them and everybody else, the whole story, in the script, in a very direct way? Or did it evolve as you were in production? Did you...
The tone of the film, the tone of the acting.
Yeah, because ultimately you're dealing with kind of this undefined sense of ennui, and you know, I'm sure it could go too far very easily, or it could go too small very easily.
Yeah, anything that's melodramatic, I don't like, and I was walking on a very fine line in this film. Mm-hmm. I didn't want the film to be cute. I think I avoided that to some extent, but with kids it's always difficult because they're so good looking that it makes the film cute whether you like it or not. Mm-hmm. But in terms of tone, I want the tone to be as realistic as possible. Often what I'll do is if I'm not sure, I'll close my eyes, I'll stop looking at them, and it goes also with adult actors, and I'll listen to them. And if I can't believe that that's a conversation I could hear in a classroom, a schoolyard, or in a cafe, I don't have it. I do it again. Mm-hmm. So I use my hearing more than my sight to direct people.
So there's a lot of silence.
Yeah.
Which is something that I think a lot of directors are afraid of these days. I think it's become in the fast cut world.
You mean the dialogues?
Or lack of dialogue. Just a character being in the moment and not having to say 300 things to fill the moment.
Yeah. There's back home, the young generation of filmmakers, they have these characters who simply don't talk. I think there's 2 pages of dialogue for an hour and a half film. Well, my perspective on that is that in real life we talk. People talk. People like talking. So I don't mind talking characters in cinema. And many great film directors have based their whole work on very talkative people. I think about Woody Allen or Eric Rohmer in France, so I don't mind dialogues. But you have to ask yourself as a filmmaker, how do you film dialogues? I think it might be a little abstract, but the verb, the sentences, the word of a person is something that can be filmed. So where are you going to put the camera? Where are you going to put the focus? What lens are you going to use? Are you going to be far away from the person? Are you going to use all kinds of unnecessary movement, camera movement, or you're just going to stick with the characters? And these are the questions that you have to ask yourself when you are filming people who are talking. And I think it's as tough as directing an accident scene. And I've done an accident scene, so filming people talking is challenging.
Do you feel like you were, I've done an accident scene. Do you feel like you've done everything? Do you feel like you're now vested as a director? Obviously, you've had great success, and
no, I feel I'm only beginning, and after 4 films, now I feel that I can see myself as a director. Mm-hmm. You have to remember, like I told you, I studied political science. I never thought I'd be doing this. So I always had the imposter syndrome. I always thought that somewhere in the room, somebody would stand up and say, "You, we know who you are. You know, get out of this business." Mm-hmm. Now I'm pretty safe that I'm pretty sure I'm going to be making at least another film. That's where I'm at.
So you don't have the urge to go off and be a gymnast?
Not yet, not yet. I would become an archaeologist, though. If things would go bad in cinema, I would love to be an archaeologist, and other journalist or, but right now filmmaking is too much fun.
Are you interested in the glam of it all at all? Or is that a
no
distraction?
When I got nominated for an Oscar, I didn't have mixed feeling. I was very happy. But the ironic thing was that I had made a very intimate film in French with no stars, and I was going to walk the red carpet with that in the most ostentatious gala in the world. And everybody around me know me, and they know that I'm not into that. But they said, Philip, get into it, or else you're going to miss the point. You know, get a tux and make sure your girlfriend has a nice dress. And so I said, yeah, okay, I'm going to play the game. So I played the game. And then when I arrived on the red carpet, there are two things in the United States that impressed me a lot. The Grand Canyon. Uh-huh. Everybody said, you should see the Grand Canyon. And you go, yeah, yeah. And then when you see the Grand Canyon, oh. The red carpet, I went, oh, all right. And it was very impressive. And it was fun because there was no pressure on me or mm-hmm. anything. And I was right behind Rooney Mara and in front of Glenn Close. So I had a ball.
So was it the grandeur of the insanity around it? Or was it being around all the celebrities? Or was it, what was it that got you?
Well, you know that you're not part of their world for sure. And mm-hmm. and when you see so many cameras, you see there are a lot of topics and issues that deserve much more camera work than that. But still, you get in the Kodak Theater, and which is not called the Kodak Theater anymore. It's illegal to say Kodak Theater now. And you look around, and there's Martin Scorsese, and there's George Clooney, and there's Steven Spielberg. And then there's this Iranian director who made a great film called A Separation. And we all share a common love for cinema. No matter if we're millionaires or not, no matter if we do studio movies or intimate films. Mm-hmm. And there was something, I always looked at the Oscar as something that didn't concern me. But in 2002, I think, I was listening to the Oscar, washing the dishes, and Steven Soderbergh came on stage for his best screenwriter for Traffic. Mm-hmm. And he said, I already thanked everybody I wanted to thank. I want to thank anybody in the world right now who is spending part of his day creating something. I don't care if it's a painting. I don't care if it's a book or a film. And I said, he's talking to me, you know, not mm-hmm. to me personally, but he's actually saying something to us everywhere around the world trying to make our little films. And that really meant something for me.
Hmm. So you felt no likelihood of going up on the stage?
This time?
Yeah.
I was prepared. I prepared myself.
Okay.
And I didn't think I was going to win. I knew Separation that, was the front runner. And the odds in Las Vegas didn't have us, winning. They do have odds on that.
I know. But you can't actually bet on them in Las Vegas. You have to go offshore.
Yeah.
You go to London and bet on them, I think.
I should have bet against my...
Yourself?
Yeah. although the odds for Separation were so bad, you would win like 20 cents on the dollar. Anyway, so I didn't expect to win, and I knew that Separation was an important film. But one day before, CNN started saying that Monsieur Lazhar might win, and mm-hmm. then New York Times also. So the people around me thought that it was possible, and they really believed that we would win. So when I heard the name Separation, I said, okay. I stood up, I clapped, I went thumbs up to Asghar, and then he went to do his speech. I listened to him, then he got off stage, and I got depressed for 20 minutes, and then I snapped out of it, and I enjoyed myself the rest
enjoyed
of the
rest
evening.
Of the party. Yeah. Well, you know, it's funny because you talk about being between Glenn Close and Rooney Mara. I mean, Glenn Close, her film was directed by a guy who makes films kind of like yours.
Yeah.
Who, you know, and she's been doing that for 20-something years trying to get this made into a movie. And it seems like you would actually be bait for, or, you know, you'd actually be able to attract a lot of actors who want to do work that's not, not always do work at least, that's commercial, that's, you know, just about making money.
I know for a fact that there's a lot of stars here that are really, really open to the idea of making small films like that, character-driven stories. And part of the work I'm trying to do now here is find a good story. Even it could be one of my own film script mm-hmm. or maybe someone else's script, and perhaps work with other actors. I'd like to do a film in English for sure. I really would love to work with a girl like Rooney Mara. I think she blew me away in Girl with Dragon Tattoo. I was against the idea of a remake, mm-hmm. and she convinced me otherwise. and I went to talk to her, and I told her that at the Oscars, mm-hmm. but I was too shy to have a real conversation, so I ran away. But I think it is possible to think that a woman like Glenn Close would accept making a smaller film. Yeah, if the character is there, if it, yeah.
So you would like to do a film here? You wouldn't mind?
It's all about...
You wouldn't feel like you were selling out to the evil Hollywood system.
No. no, I don't see myself doing a studio movie except, like I said, Star Trek or James Bond.
Keep it in mind.
there's Friedel.
It took a minute for Friedel to get in there. you got to say something funny, I guess.
About the script.
Yeah.
When you think about it, the two questions. Do I like the script? Am I the right person to do it? I would not embark on a script, even though I think it's a very good story. But if I don't think I have the skill to do it, I will not do it. I will not do a film for money, and I will not do a film just because a star is attached to it, for sure. I have to feel that I'm the right person to do that script.
So you're probably not going to do the next Adam Sandler movie.
He played in some good movies. he played in
he
some
has,
good
actually.
Movies.
Yeah, and he worked with some really interesting
directors. I liked Spanglish. So.
Yeah,
I like the Paul Thomas Anderson film.
Punch Drunk Love.
Yeah, there's a few good films with him.
Yeah, there's something going on in there. he is the Jerry Lewis of his generation.
He is, actually, yeah.
And was your movie funded with state funds primarily?
Is that it's thing? Always back home. 90% of the films are state funded, and that's what allows us to make the films we were making and to keep artistic control over. The end product, and I think we don't have the best system in the world, but we have a good system, I think.
So do you think that the system here of trying to scrape up the dollars would make you crazy?
It's just
or you want to find out.
It's just that if it's all private money, you have to concede some of the stuff along the way. You cannot. I realized that I could not be in total control of everything. Mm-hmm. There are a few guys that seem to be doing that, like Wes Anderson or Paul Thomas Anderson, mm-hmm. all the Andersons.
Paul W.S. Anderson, of course. The Underworld series is just out of control.
Yeah.
Or not Underworld, his is the other one. His is Resident Evil, sorry.
Oh, yeah.
I don't want to misstate the W.S. Anderson story.
But even back home, my film before that cost like $5 million, which is a big deal for us. Mm-hmm. And it didn't do too good at the box office. It won all kinds of awards around the world, but it didn't do good at the box office back home. And I had a problem with that. I said, I'm not going to go around spending, you know, the public's money if the people are not going to see the film. But I'm not going to also try writing a script just to please the audience. I want to write the scripts that I have inside of me. So it's a difficult balance to find.
So you're going to do Adam Sandler in a remake of Taxi?
I don't know. Let's not speculate about my American adventures now.
Is there a Canadian version of The Artist you could do? Is that really confuse people?
No, but since it's a French film, maybe we can convince Hollywood to do more films in French. It's
there's only one word.
And it was in English.
And it was in English, yes.
It was in English, so it's still an English film.
Beautifully accented English. I think Jean is still working on his English.
I think he doesn't speak English. I think he learns phonetically.
Well,
the
he
words.
Tried. He was trying really hard, and it's been a lot of months trying to get it right. And
I was disappointed with his speech. Jean, j'étais déçu de ton speech aux Oscars. No, he could have done better than that, but he was really emotional about it. But
yes.
I think when you're on stage and you're speaking to, 500 million people, you have to say something intelligent.
Well, that's the thing about Harvey Weinstein is eventually you're just tired. So you see all the people who won, they tended to just look exhausted, like they were at the end of a long...
I was fresh, I was ready, I had something to say.
Or Oscar always has something to say. He was pretty good. He did a pretty good speech, I'd say.
Yeah.
But we would have loved to hear yours, and I'm sorry we didn't.
Won't happen.
Won't happen?
No, I thought of making a short film, going to see some major actors, and because they all have their speech somewhere that they never, you know, said, and have a small film like 7 minutes, and have a few people making their speech or part of their speech in front of the camera, the speech that was never heard.
And you could win an Oscar for that short. Or lose an Oscar for that short and not give the speech.